Test. Okay, here we are. Happy Father's Day, everybody. Welcome. I would start by saying we'll be outside again next week. I'm not sure about after that, but hopefully soon we'll be back in. But it's nice outside, and I'm glad that you're all here. And I do want to say Happy Father's Day to all of our fathers. And being that we don't have the projector, we won't get to watch our Father's Day video, but I sent that in the email this morning, so look for your inbox for that, and you can watch today's video. And what I said was, I've never made a Father's Day video myself, but if I ever did, it would be pretty close to the one that I sent you today. So I hope that you enjoyed that. Let's take a minute and pray for our fathers. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are such a great example of a father to us, because you have provided everything we need. You love us, but you also train us up in the way that we should go. And you're not above disciplining us, Lord, because you love us. And Lord, I know that not all earthly fathers come close to your standard. And far too many people grow up being hurt by their dad. And I pray, Lord, that for those people that you would bring them hope and encouragement and healing, Lord, and someone maybe to share with. And I just pray that they would meet you as a true God, true Heavenly Father who loves them with all of your heart. And Lord, for all of our fathers here today as we celebrate, I just pray that we would be thankful, Lord, for the opportunity that you have given us to influence and to change a life, Lord. And I pray that we would recommit ourselves, Lord, just to loving our children as you love us, your children, Lord. And so I pray that we'll be able to celebrate well today with that. And Lord, as we worship you and get into your word, it's our hope and our prayer that you'll be honored. Show us who you are, Lord. Reveal yourself to us. Just help us to enjoy the blessings of your presence and each other. In Jesus' name we pray.
I don't worship. golden ever-risen land. One perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One in himself I cannot die. My soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior.
For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. Jesus, thank you for your sacrifice on the cross, Lord. In these times of uncertainty, Father, I pray that that's what we would anchor. That we would anchor into you and your word, into your love and into your peace, Lord. That you would still the waters around us, Lord God, and bring home. Father, this is something only you can do. Man's attempt is throwing gas on a fire. Lord, we need your spirit to intercede for us, Lord. We need your spirit to overwhelm us, to overtake us, and to blanket our nation. In Jesus' name, amen.
So in addition to being Father's Day, this is actually the 50th anniversary of our church, which was incorporated on June 21st, 1970 as North Vista Baptist Church. And we began planning, I think late last year, for some activities which obviously aren't gonna happen. We should have already sent out invitations in that. I really appreciate Angela's work and you can getting this organized, and we will be doing it when we can. If you look in the fellowship hall, there's some of the plans that we made, as well as the time capsule, which will happen at some point as well. But I wanted to take a minute before I get into the message and just thank the Lord for 50 years and just pray for the next 50. So please join with us. Heavenly Father, it is such a blessing to have 50 years, Lord. And just as I was thinking about that, the parable of the sower came to my heart, because Jesus talked about the sower who went out to sow, and he broadcast seed, and some of it fell on rocky soil, some on thorny soil, some of it was burned up, but some of it fell on good soil, Lord. And as a church, as we have tried to sow the good seed for 50 years, Lord, I'm thankful that some of it has fallen on good soil. And I just thank you for all the lives that have been changed from this place. People who met you here, were baptized here, who learned to use our spiritual gifts here, who continue to serve you this day, Lord, some on the mission field and some in different parts of the country and some still here, Lord. And we thank you because that's your desire for us. And yet, Lord, when I look around and see our neighborhood, our community, Lord, it's like a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. So desperate for you. And we have that water of living, that living water. And, Lord, I just pray that as a priority in our lives, one of the things about this world is there are so many things to do, living in San Diego, living in the United States, there's so many things that will mess with our priorities. And yet I pray, Lord, that as we looked at last week, that we will desire most of all to be fishers of men. Because no matter what we do, if we change someone's life to know you, that's eternal, Lord. Help us to put that at the top of our list for you, Lord. And Lord, I just pray for our church here and our church to come. And I pray that in 50 years, if you aren't having to come back, we'll still be here. I mean, not me, not anybody probably maybe sitting here, but we'll still be here because we are the church. And Lord, I just pray for your vision and your revelation for us, Lord, because I know that we're not all that you want us to be, not by any stretch, Lord. And so, Lord, again, I just pray that our priority would be to serve you first, think of ourselves separate, Lord. And we just pray that the best days ahead are ahead for life, which is, Lord. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. And I just want to take a quick prayer for the offering. Heavenly Father, thank you for providing our needs all these years. And we are blessed to have this land, to have it paid for, to have the money in the bank. And Lord, still it's our desire that the things that you have given to us, that we would use them wisely, Father, that we would be good stewards of what you've entrusted us with. And that we would use the resources that you've given us to sow more seeds so that more people could give. And so I just thank you for the faithful believers, Lord, who keep the lights on and the doors open here, and just pray that we'll all be faithful to what you call us to do as far as we can. In Jesus' name. Okay, we're going through a time where every week I just kind of seek the Lord and say, what do we have for this week, Lord? And as I was kind of thinking and watching all the news and things about reopenings and getting together, I was just realizing that the best reunion of all time is yet to come. And so we're going to look at the reunion checklist. And what I mean by that is we have a reunion with Jesus coming, and we want to be ready for that. We want to be ready for that. So I'll get into that. The first, if you have your Bibles, please turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18, talking about this reunion. It says, "Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage each other with these words." And I really hope that those words are an encouragement to you. The thought of being reunited with Jesus and with other brothers and sisters in him around the world, that is an encouragement to you. Other reunions that we think about, I think when we think about the word reunion, we think about high school reunions. I don't know if any of you ever gone to a high school reunion. I never have. I moved away from where my high school was very soon after I graduated and never really looked back. And I'm not sure I'd be all excited about going to a high school reunion after 42 years anyway. But I went online, and there's all kinds of ways, sites that'll help you get prepared, not just to hold the reunion, but, you know, diets that work really fast so that you can look good, and maybe the best toupee, the best double quick plastic surgery so you can impress all of the people that you used to go to school with. because we always want to look good. But the reality is that when we have a reunion with the Lord, he knows us inside and out already. There's nothing that we can change right now that will change how he feels about us. He loves us. And it's one of those things to see how his plans are best. A while back, Garth Brooks recorded a song called Unanswered Prayers. And it was a song about how he was glad after he met his girlfriend in high school, the girl he wanted to be his girlfriend in high school, how that didn't work out, and then he met his wife. And he was so happy for unanswered prayers because he met the true love of his life. And I think high school reunions are probably the place where there is the most gratitude for unanswered prayers of anywhere, because you get together with all these people you used to think were cool, and you realize, what in the world am I thinking? I wanted to date him, or I wanted to go out with her. Are you kidding me? And so sometimes God's greatest blessings are when he doesn't answer our prayers the way that we want, but he answers them according to what is best for us. The word reunion means the act of uniting again, the state of being united again, a gathering of relatives, friends, or associates at regular intervals or after separation, a family reunion. And that definition just makes me long all the more for that time when we will come back together with Jesus and with people we don't even know from around the world. And I've said this many times, but our real family is not citizens of the United States. Our real family is those around the world who call Jesus Christ Savior and Lord. And what a great reunion that will be. And let me read again from 1 Thessalonians 4, the best reunion. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. What an awesome thing that is going to be. So we're going to look at the items on our reunion checklist. How to be prepared for that meeting. And you don't have to do a diet or anything. It's a spiritual preparation. And number one is be sure to RSVP. Be sure to RSVP. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." We have to believe, and we'll look a little bit more about what that means. But not everybody is going to be there at that reunion. Some people have a family reunion. There's a family member that they might not want to invite. Well, not everybody makes it to this reunion either. There's a website called reserveaspotinheaven.com. And at that spot, you can go, and there's nothing about God or the Bible. It isn't religious, but they offer you a money-back guarantee that you'll have a spot in heaven, which is really an easy thing to do because how are you going to collect? according to the website, for only $14.95, you get a letter confirming your reservation in heaven. I'm not sure what zip code that comes from, but you also get a certificate suitable for framing with your name on it, some bogus information about heaven, and an embossed name tag for heaven, which I guess you can put on a lanyard and wear so that they know you belong. And if you want to upgrade, for only $10 more, you can get the VIP all-access pass for heaven. When I say you need to make your reservation for heaven, obviously that's not how it works. That same company has a website, Reserve a Spot in Hell, for those who want to go the other way. I don't really think you need a reservation for that one. I think they take all comers in there. And that's a spoof, but seriously, thousands of people use them as gag gifts. And for too many people, that's what the idea of heaven and hell has become, especially hell. Why would we even think about there being a hell? But the truth is, if we want to be part of that reunion with Jesus, we need to RSVP. Revelation 21:27 says, regarding the New Jerusalem, nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Which begs the question, is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? It's the only way to take part in that reunion that I read about in 1 Thessalonians. There's a tombstone in Indiana that says, "Consider, friend, as you pass by, as you are now, so once was I. As I am now, you soon shall be. So prepare, my friend, and follow me." Someone unhappy with that message put another verse on the tombstone, which says, "To follow you is not my intent until I know which way you went." Sometimes we need all the information on that. It's not just enough to say, "Follow me." It's, "Where are you going?" And if we're following Jesus, we're going to get our reservation in to go to heaven. And I think that a lot of people worry too much about, "Am I going to make it?" 1 John 5:13 says, "I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life." John says we can know. We can know in our hearts that we are right with him, and that we are going to spend eternity with him, and that we are going to have a place at that great reunion when Jesus comes back. So number one on the checklist, be sure to RSVP. Number two, be sure to repent. Be sure to repent. And I mean regularly. You may think, "Well, I did that. That's why I'm going to heaven. But, you know, we're going to meet Jesus. We need to be pure. Psalm 24, 3 and 4 says, who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart. We need to have clean hands and a pure heart to stand before God in his place. How do we get that? Well, by trying to do better next time? By working a little harder? By doing more good? No. More good works? No. Only by repenting from our heart. Psalm 51, verses 2 and 4. This is a psalm that David wrote after he had sinned with Bathsheba. And he said, wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgression, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned. I want to pause there for just a second. You know, it seems like maybe Bathsheba and Uriah the Hittite might disagree that only against God did David sin. I mean, Bathsheba's there, and her baby that she had with David because of their adulterous relationship is dead. Uriah the Hittite is dead because it was the only way David could figure to hide his sin. And yet David, in this situation, when he's praying to God, says, against you only have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. And we need to have David's heart in that and realize that our sin isn't just a little oops, it's not a little white lie. It's an affront to God. And if we're going to be spending eternity with him, we want to have all of those things taken care of before we go to meet him for that reunion. And we can keep short accounts with God if our heart is pure enough to acknowledge when we're wrong and ask for forgiveness. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. He will purify us from all unrighteousness. And in that state, we will join together with him and all the other believers and celebrate eternity in heaven. So we need to make our SVP. We need to be sure to repent. And then number three, we need to be sure to forgive others. We need to be sure to forgive others. Because as much as we need forgiveness from God, we need to extend that to those who have wronged us. Matthew chapter 5, verses 23 and 24 says, therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled to your brother. Then come and offer your gift. Now, as a pastor, I'd rather you just be able to give the gift. But Jesus says, you've got to go and make things right with your brothers and sisters before you make that offer. So even if you're just there doing something totally spiritual, offering a gift on the altar, he says, go back and make it right. Because when you come to him, you want to be not only right with God, but also with your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. Matthew chapter 6, verses 14, I don't think it could be much more clear. Jesus from the Sermon on the Mount says, for if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. So if you don't want your sins forgiven, hold on to the things what people have hurt you. Hold on to them and have an unforgiving heart. Perhaps the most poignant example of this in the scripture, at least in my mind, I just kind of get chills every time I read this last verse. But Jesus told the story of a master who had two servants. Both of them owed him money. One owed him like $1 million, basically. And then that servant had another servant who owed him like $10. And so we pick up in Matthew 18, with verse 32. It says, then the master called the servant in. Oh, I'm sorry. So the master goes to the servant and pleads for forgiveness from the debt, and how he can't go on. He's got to be forgiven that debt. And all the reasons why. And so the master forgives that debt. And so immediately, this servant who has been forgiven $1 million debt goes to the guy who owes him $10 and says, well, pay me what you owe me. And the guy says, please, have time. Give me some time. Forgive me. I'll work it out. And essentially, the first servant has the second servant thrown in debtor's jail until he can pay it up. And when the master hears about that, then the master called the first servant in and said, you wicked servant, I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? In anger, his master turned him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should be paid back all he owed. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart. Let me repeat that last verse again. This is how my heavenly Father will treat you unless you forgive your brother from your heart. Clearly, in Jesus' mind, when we have something against a brother or sister in the Lord, we have something against our Father in heaven. And that's why when we get together for that reunion, we need to be right. We need to be right with each other. So I just implore you, if there's something that is between you and a fellow brother or sister in Christ, make that right. I mean, the verse from the first verse I read from this point, just drop what you're doing. Go and make it right, because that is the Lord's desire for you. Number four, be sure to lead with grace. Be sure to lead with grace. So what I mean by that is when we go into the presence of God to get together for that union, grace is what should be foremost in our mind, because the options are we can lead with our righteous acts, we can lead with our good intentions, we can lead with our good works, but none of that is going to get us anywhere. That's why we need to, when we go to have that reunion, we need to be sure to lead with grace. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10 says, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for you to do. So what that tells us is it is not of works, because no one could boast. Because if we could get to heaven by works, there would be a lot of boasting going on, wouldn't there? That doesn't honor God. But it's by grace, not works, so that no one can boast. But where works come in is in verse 10, where it says, for we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. And the Greek word there for workmanship literally means that we are his piece of art. We are his masterpiece. And he's prepared things for us to do, which we need to do. But when we come to meet him, we need to lead with grace, because that's why we're there. Because grace has brought me safe this far, and grace will lead me home. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. If we're based on our goodness, we're going to fall short. But if we lead with grace and understanding of what all that Jesus did for us when he died on the cross, we can be assured of our place with that reunion. So point number five, after you've made your RSVP, after you've repented, after you've forgiven others, and when you're leading with grace, number five, be sure to bring your resume. Be sure to bring your resume. And you may think, well, you just said it's all by grace, Pastor Frank, so what are you talking about bringing your resume? Isn't that your work? Well, Jesus told two parables. One parable told the story of laborers in a vineyard. And a vineyard owner had some work to do, so he started hiring people early in the morning. Then he hired some more a little later in the day, and then at lunchtime, and then even hired some right before quitting time. And when it came time to pay out the wages, he gave everybody the same wage. And the guy that had been there all day was a little frustrated with that and said, I've been here all so much longer than this guy, he made the same. But the point of that parable is it doesn't matter when you come. We all get salvation, whether it's a deathbed confession or somebody who's tried to serve God all their life. Salvation is for anybody, anytime. But it's important to see that Jesus also told another parable, the parable of the talents, which we'll look a little at in just a second. But in that, we see that the master gives different talents, different values what was considered money at that point, a word for money. And they were supposed to go out and do something with it to three different guys. Two of these guys doubled it, came back, and found joy in their master, with their master. One of his very good talent, and he didn't. And so it's like we are responsible for what God has given us. So we need to bring with us not just our certificate, not just our RSVP, but also our resume that shows how we have worked for God. And I think, you know, a verse that's really overlooked in our in the church too much is 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 10 through 15. It says, by the grace God has given me, I laid a foundation as an expert builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should be careful how he builds, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. If any man builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stone, wood, hay, or straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. And I think that this is an important verse because it shows that when we meet the Lord, it's not just about are we saved, but if our work, when we get through the fire, it says, we will receive our reward. Unfortunately, there will be those who make it into heaven with singed eyebrows because they've got it through the flames, but everything about their life was just burned up. Now, isn't that a sad thing to think about? And, it's like I'm continually amazed that eternity is such a long time. I mean, eternity is, it started long before I came, and it's going to go on forever, right? And the way God set things up is we've got, you know, maybe 100 years to live and to build up our spiritual resume for that appointment that we have with God. And everything that we do in those 100 years is going to be evaluated for eternity. And I don't want to spend my whole life building something that's just going to get burned up. And unfortunately, I think that describes far too many people in our country and around the world. We're just making kindling for that fire, where the Word of God says, build so that it's going to last. Build your life with silver, costly stones, gold, with things that are going to maybe be refined in the fire, but they're going to make it clear. So that, as Paul says, you can receive your reward. And that's not saying you're not saved. He makes it quite clear. Even if everything that you do gets burned up and you suffer loss, you're still saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. So we will bring our resume for God to evaluate what we have done. And I really hope in everybody's heart that you will all just see that there's nothing, there's no reward here on earth that is worth losing our rewards in heaven for us. And it's based just on this short time. I mean, let's be focused for this short time. And then we die and we get to go and be with Jesus. What an amazing thing. What a truly amazing thing. And then getting back to the parable of the talents, Matthew 25, 19 through 21 says, after a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. So the master has given 10, 5, and 1 talent to his servants and said, go do your thing. And then they come back, and this is how it went, starting in verse 20. The man who had received the 5 talents brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 talents. See, I've gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Now, how many want to hear that from the Lord when we meet him for the day? I know I do. This first guy had a great resume to give to the master. And then when we get down to verses 24 through 27, he comes to the guy who had 1 talent, who received 1 talent, and this is how that works. It says, then the one who had received the 1 talent came Master, he said, I knew you were a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid. And I want to pause there for just a minute. You know, for far too many believers, that I was afraid verse keeps them from giving the resume that they should have. I was afraid because of a misunderstanding of who God was, or too good of an understanding of who God was. I was afraid to use my gift because I thought people might laugh at me. I was afraid because, pick your excuse. Far too many believers are gonna stand at the reunion with God and say, sorry, but I was afraid. Let's see how that works for this guy. Verse 25, so I was afraid and went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers. So when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. When we go to meet the Lord, are we just going to give him what he has given us? Are we going to bring him more? So if I read this correctly, we want to bring him more. Because if all we were going to do is give him back what he's already given us, then why even live? We might as well just go straight to heaven and enjoy that. But our time here on earth is a time to make the most of what he's given us, so we can hear those words, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with the little, I will put you in charge of much. And while I don't exactly know for sure what that means or what the implications are for when we get to heaven, but that's what the Word of God says. When we meet the Master, he says, I'll put you in charge of a lot. And I want to be there with a resume that honors and pleases my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Then the sixth point in the reunion checklist. So we've made our SVP, we've repented, we are sure to forgive others, we've led with grace because our works don't cut it, and then we have worked on our resume, so that it's one that brings honor to God. And then point number six, be sure to have a party spirit. Be sure to have a party spirit. And many of you may be thinking, that's not what I expected him to say there, but I believe that's true. I believe we have a celebratory God who loves to celebrate with his people. And I think that's evidenced in Luke chapter 15, one of the most famous chapters in the Bible, where it talks about lost things. And there's a lost sheep, a lost coin, and most famously a lost son, who we call the prodigal son. But let's look at what happens when something that was lost is found. Luke 15, verses 6 through 7 says, then he calls his friends after he's found the sheep. He calls his friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me. I have found my lost sheep. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not repent. The shepherd celebrates finding a lost sheep. God celebrates when those who are lost spiritually repent and come back. Then in regard to the lost coin, in Luke 15, 9 through 10, it says, and when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin. In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. So when lost things are found, there is a celebration. And then finally, we get to the story of the prodigal son, or the lost son. The lost son who went to his dad and said, I just want my inheritance now. I don't want to be with you. I'm going to go live my life. So he takes the money. He squanders it on wild living. He loses it all. He ends up feeding the pigs, which most of the Jewish boys would not find to be a very good occupation. And so he's pondering his options, and he gets his whole speech together and says, well, I'm going to go back to dad, and I'm going to say, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm not even worthy to be called your son. Just let me work in the fields, because I know that working in your field is better than what I was doing, so have mercy. And he's walking back home, he's probably rehearsing with my father, not sinning against. The father sees him from far away, and he doesn't wait for the son to get home, but he runs and meets the prodigal son. And then the prodigal son starts with a speech, but he gets interrupted by the joy of the father just that he has come home. And so he calls for a big party, for a big celebration. He's still the fatted calf, and so they're going to celebrate. And the other son is not all that happy about what's going on, and he goes to the father and says, I have been faithful and loyal to you all these years. What have you ever asked of me that I didn't do? And yet you didn't kill a goat for me, and here you're killing a fatted calf for this. We believe that spend all your money, and now he's come back. And the father's heart is, Luke 16:32, but we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive. He was lost. Hopefully, if you learn anything from Luke 16, it's that God wants to celebrate when sinners come to repent. And he loves to have be reunited with those who were lost and now found. So does that tell you, give you any kind of indication what a great party that reunion of 1 Thessalonians 4 is going to be when we all are assembled, when all of us who are all sinners who fall short of the glory of God yet repent and forgive others and lead with grace and build a resume that God is proud of? Can you imagine what a celebration that's going to be? God the Father in that story was so blessed that his father who had, that excuse me, his son who had blown out so much of his own stuff came back to celebrate. When all of those prodigals come together and meet Jesus in the sky, what a celebration. Another instance of that in Scripture is Matthew 22, verses 1 through 4. It says, Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some servants and said, tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner, my oxen, fatted calf have been butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet. God is looking, really looking forward to this wedding banquet. And if you've read all of this in the New Testament, you know that there is a groom, his name is Jesus. There is a bride, and the bride of Christ is all of us, his church, all who have chosen to follow him. And he is preparing a celebratory wedding banquet for us. And what this story in Matthew 22 is telling us is that he prepared that for the Jews, but they were too busy. They had reasons why they didn't want to come. They refused to come. And as we go through, and there's excuses in that, and finally, the father, the king, says, well, go and get whoever will come. And that's kind of where we come in. Because those who didn't respond to the banquet opened the door for us to get that invitation. Literally, it says, the king says to his servants, go out into the roads, into the highways, into the byways, and bring in anyone who will come. And that's our invitation. And they come to the party, to the celebration. I think God gets a rap as being a negative God, a dour God. He's always got a sour look on his face. You don't know God except through conceptual. Our God is a party God who loves to celebrate. I just honestly wish we gave him no reason to celebrate. But there's a big party plan for that great reunion when we go to meet Jesus in his presence. The question is, have you made your own? Have you truly repented of these things and continue to repent? Have you forgiven those around you who you have something against or who have something against you? Are you leading with grace? Are you working, building a great resume? Were you taking what God has given you and multiplied it for kingdom? And are you ready for a great celebration when we all get together? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, look forward to that day, Lord. I thank you just for all the promises that are in Scripture. And I think the one that I most look forward to is to sing together with you, Lord, first of all, but with like-minded souls and spirits who have forsaken the world to follow you. And I thank you that you are preparing a banquet for us and that we will just rejoice in your presence. Father, I just pray for anybody who is here in the parking lot, on the grass, who might be watching on the internet, Lord, just to consider, have I made my own future? There's so many things to do in this life. But fast forward to the end, there's only one thing to do. I come, I confess, I am a sinner and not worthy of your grace. Please forgive me by the blood of Jesus. I will follow you forever with all of my heart. With love. If you need to pray that prayer right now, pray that prayer in your heart. Just have a pause here while you do the most exciting. Pray for those who don't know them. If you do know them, pray for those who don't know them. Lord, I thank you that regardless of what we think of the best fighting we've ever been through here on earth, Lord, it's going to be up to the church, but help us all to be there for that great meeting. Thank you, that promise that we use this word. Amen. If you're serious about being here for that meeting and you're not sure what that means, then I'm happy to talk to you for that meeting. Being on your car and coming and talking to me, if you mean contacting me through our website, www.lifepointchurchvista.com, or whatever it takes. But that RSVP is the most important RSVP you'll ever make, and I pray that you make it before it's due. Well, God bless y'all. We'll see you here next Sunday at 10. Every week, usually on Wednesday, I send out an email that updates you on different things with the church. If you would like, if you're not getting that and you would like to, make sure I have your email address and I will add you to that. And God bless you. I pray you have a great celebration of Father's Day and a great week. That this week you do something to build your resume, something that's going to last. God bless y'all.
have a good week. Stay safe.